post every year, we'll do incident analysis both on specific fires and broadly across all fires across the state. And then we pick out the key learnings from those, and they become themes for the following year. So if you like, I'll look here and say warnings and advice. Well, it comes as a no-brainer. We did warnings and advice really well last year, but there was a couple of things about them. We did lots of them, and you could say we had quantity. We didn't have quality as much as possible. And so the general feedback from everybody, and probably including us, we got bombarded with warnings. Great. CFA did lots of warnings, but how about more timely, more accurate information? And also we broadened it out to say multilingual people, a broader area that we could tap into as well. And if you like, that whole warning space since Black Saturday has almost been an iterative or an improved process. Every year we get a little bit better, so we'll review it. So I suspect warnings and advice will come up every year. Command and control arrangements, we're still working towards coming together as the different agencies, so we work to one. And the Fire Service Commissioner talks about, and I think he will talk about, one agency, one force, if you like, working together. So what we're trying to do continually is saying same standards, same processes. So when we do go, it doesn't matter what badge is on your shirt, we all have some confidence and respect for each other when we come together. The transfer of control. Well, what that means is when CFA, if I go to, we do 35 upwards of 40,000 calls a year. Most of those are what we would call level one jobs. Anything from a rubbish bin fire to a house fire to a small grass fire. So we manage that ourselves, just internally, if you like. What then happens, of course, is as they get bigger and bigger and bigger, we transfer control out of our agency into the bigger sector, what we call level threes, if you like. And there's still a lot of issues about when the trigger points are when we say, here, we're giving the responsibility of this fire from the chief officer to the fire service commissioner. So if it's a rubbish bin fire, house fire, it stays with the chief officer and within the CFA command structure. Gets much bigger than that, then we transfer control over to the control arrangements of the state. When that happens, how that happens, is still points of conjecture that we're continually wanting to improve on. Some people, you won't find this hard, might find this hard to believe, don't want a hand transfer over. I'm running this job well, I don't want to give it to the state. I've got enough resources here. What rights do they have to take my job? Now, that would never happen in CFA, etc. And on the other side of the fence, you do have people at the high level going, hang on, this job's getting big, we should take this one over. So there's still a little bit of tension there about when, how, and what. So there's a lot of work being done in transfer and control. Traffic management points. Again, it's really a contentious issue that comes up probably every year. And with traffic management points, it is things like, an example would be, we got criticised, for instance, for not allowing vets to return into past the fire line. But we put up barriers and said no one goes in there because it's dangerous. But we had lots of stock, particularly in the Gippsland area, that were injured and not well, that really we needed to get to vets to properly euthanise or to deal with vets. So it was something we'd actually not on our radar, not core business. We hadn't really thought about it. The DPI said to us, hey, you buggers, you need to let us in. So, okay, we need to change our practice. We need to provide a bit more clarity about who does and who doesn't get through traffic management points. So there's a bit of work happened there. All learnings, and there was about three others that came up from the previous years that we've worked on to try and improve on for this year.
It's great to be back again for what is the preparedness for the next summer. If you look back though, we had a great summer last year. It was a very long summer, it was a very hot summer, and it challenged us a lot. There was a lot of fires that were controlled in the initial stages, which was a huge success, and only a few that caused us significant concern and major resources. So if you look at that and say, well done, we now need to build off that and ensure that we are right for the next summer. The Bureau is clearly indicating it's got the potential to be a fire season of significance, but it's much broader than that. It's not just about fire, it's got to be about heat, it's got to be about windy days, it's got to be about the dryness that we've got, and fires are obviously one of those primary issues that we always face in Victoria. Primacy of life, protection of our people, has got to be critical. Likewise, safety of our crews, and safety's got to be up front everything we do. There are two messages, but there's more than that. It's about us working together, and we clearly say now we work as one. It's a simple set of words, but from the initial tack all the way through to what will be a major incident, we need to work as one and stay together, work together, understand, respect, but do it together. And I think that's absolutely critical. Also, there's a lot of opportunities that we'll have this season. Some of them are identified in the briefings and exercises we're working through now. Evacuation, traffic management, issuing information to the community and warnings, command and control, initial attack, are all critical parts of what this exercise and briefing series of events across the state will bring. But it starts here, and we ask you to take this home for you, to your brigade, to your SES unit, to your work location. Take it back and make sure what you talk about here, you take back to the others, and they need your support to do that. So it's not the end of something, it's the start of the journey. I hope it's not a long summer, but no doubt in Victoria we'll still have a summer, and every time we have a summer we have those issues of fires or heat issues to deal with. And I say, let's do it together. We're a great team in Victoria. Let's keep the great team being great. And I wish you all the best for what will be a challenging, but I've got no doubt a successful summer season.
So you see some key themes that have continued to be reinforced in that. We work as one, command and control, transfer control, same sort of issues that we they've almost themed up for us this year. The one slide that we've put in for this presentation that hasn't gone around the state is this one here. And it's only because of a currency perspective. We often get asked, well, what's the season going to be? Short of having a crystal ball, I guess no one can really tell us with any definitive outlook of what it is going to be. I usually say this, that in Victoria, we are one of the three documented scientific research worst wildfire, bushfire, whatever you want to call it, places in the world. And it is because we have good rain. And what have we got? Good rain. We have a hot centre of the country that provides hot northerly winds and a wind change that comes through about 5:30. So if you put all that together, on any given day we can have a fire. So it's really hard, and everyone's having a chuckle at Ewan's expense trying to do a... He was out the front literally 5 minutes ago, standing under an umbrella, pouring down rain, trying to give everybody a fire safety message. And it really is quite difficult. But the reality is, and we've seen even early in the season, I think yesterday or the day before, quite windy, quite warm, had a couple of fires that have run. But if you look here, the predictions are warmer summer days expected for eastern Australia, and also average chance of rainfall for Victoria, dry season expected much. You can read that for yourself. If particularly the Bureau, call them splinters because they sit on the fence, but the average chance of rainfall, what's that mean? You know, like, yeah, that's bizarre. But anyway, the reality is for us, we expect we will lose houses at somewhere in the state. Now, it's like Russian roulette. I can't tell you where that is. I can't tell you when it's going to happen. But on our forecasting, on similar years, lead-up years, we've lost houses in some parts of the state. So it's not unlikely that somewhere in Victoria, particularly during January, February, and March, we will lose some homes. We've already had some significant fires, and I'm sure we will continue to have more fires as the season goes on. It's just the way of the world. It's just where we live and what's going to be, what's going to happen, and what we can expect in here. Just to reinforce that, we've now got a briefing from Tony Bannister from the Weather Bureau.
Hi, I want to talk to you about three topics in this pre-season fire weather briefing. First of these is the climate outlook for spring. Now, a couple of things we tend to look at. First of those is a thing called the ENSO. And what that is you may have know that in terms of El Nino and La Nina. And that's in a neutral phase. So really that is no real help to us at the moment. The other thing that we look at, that's in the Pacific, the other thing that we look at is what's happening over in the Indian Ocean, a thing called the Indian Ocean Dipole. And since May, that's been in negative territory. And what that usually means for southern Australia is that over the winter-spring period, that it usually gets more rain than normal. And what we've had over winter so far is it has panned out pretty well, that most of Victoria has had more rain than normal. So in terms of the outlook for Victoria, this Indian Ocean Dipole, which is expected to last into mid-spring, plus the above-average sea surface temperatures around Victoria, give an indication that for the central parts of Victoria is a likelihood of more rain than normal, and also a corresponding likelihood of less than a maximum temperature. Okay, now we'll talk about the second topic. This is, you may remember last season that we introduced forecasts for the next day at 25 locations, giving weather information at the time of maximum fire danger. Now, what has been decided is this will become the standard part of the standard product set for the next 4 days. And whereas in previous years we've given you forecasts at the time of maximum temperature, what we were doing now will be, from this season on, is give you information at time of max fire danger. This is because we're now looking at all our spatial and spot location forecasts at time of max fire danger. So this would become our standard forecast for the next 4 days. The third topic I'd like to talk about is about a system called METI. METI is a one-stop shop online weather briefing tool that will display current and forecast conditions over Victoria as well as Australia that you can bring up on your web. Things like current, you can bring up temperature, RH, wind speed, direction, even radar and satellite imagery. And looking out into our forecasts, you can bring up things like wind or temperature or RH. If you're used to using Google Maps, then you'll be pretty comfortable with METI in terms of zooming and panning and putting layers on and off. So I hope this information is useful in your preparation for the season, and the Bureau will keep you updated right through the season.
It's interesting when you listen to people like Tony in hindsight, or retrospectively, to say he actually said it was going to be colder and wetter, and I think that was realised, wasn't it, the coldest period of time? So it's interesting looking back. But they're now also forecasting warmer from now on in, so if they're consistent with their messaging, then that's the way it's going to be. Some doctrinal changes that we've been working on, and I'm just conscious of the time now, but State Command and Control Arrangements for Bushfire. Believe it or not, there is a document that all the chiefs sign up to say that we work as a one team. Emergency Management Team Arrangements. Emergency Management Team, that is effectively what used to happen in the dim, dark ages, probably only a couple of years ago, is that we would go in with a lens of just putting out a fire. So we would go there and say, look, our job is to put out the fire, we pack up, we go home. And it goes for other incidents as well. What we've identified, only took us about 100 years, but is to say events such as a fire or an emergency event affect so many more people. So at the time of an incident, we set up what we call an emergency management team. So an emergency management team may have local people represented on it. They may have council. If it's a particular fire in an area, we may have recovery people. We may have vets. You may have people that would be impacted, and straight to mind would be the power industries. You know, AusNet, SP AusNet and the gas companies are now saying, we want in. We want in your decision making. We want to be part of the journey. So we've set up what we call emergency management teams, and they're on site or they're in ICC. So you can have them at incident, at region or at state. So incident management, emergency management team, a regional emergency management team, or a state emergency management team. And their whole idea is to make sure that those other parties that are not directly involved in the firefight have got an input or a knowledge about what's going on. So it's a two-way street, if you like. So that process has been refined to ensure that we have local representation. Then there's a view now to say it's not just utilities. It is about, if there's a fire in your community, is it the mayor? Who is representing your community on an emergency management team? The JSOP arrangements, and very quickly, what we identified last year is we keep building systems. And so we've said, right, I think last year we said we've got 40 level 3 IMTs across the state, ICCs across the state, and on any trigger point day, a recommendation out of the Royal Commission, you must, CFA, DSE, Parks Vic, MFB, SES, have X amount of people in there. And so we've gone, oh beauty, okay, we've got 40 times 40 people, therefore we need literally thousands of people on standby on any given day. Trouble when you look around, there's no one to go in trucks because they're all in IMTs at Manning. I'll now embellish that a little bit. But a real example was that we had the fire in first fire last year in the western part of the state, and we couldn't resource the IMT. Why? Because everybody else in the state were going, no, I'm Manning to Major JSOP. I have to have these people in place, and I'm not letting them go. So we couldn't move people around the state. So we've done a lot of work to say, let's cut down the number of ICCs we have to man from 40 to 20. Let's increase the footprint they look after. If something happens in that footprint, then let's move resources in to accommodate that particular area. So it's a real rethink about how we man up. This is just readiness. This is not when we go to war. This is just say tomorrow's going to be a bad day. We need to have people in place by 10 o'clock, and this is the number we're going to have in place. So that's had a complete overhaul and review. And a lot of times, I've already talked about the guidelines for operations traffic management points during bushfires. So I won't address that again. Aims for, what you may or may not know, is that we run across Australia, New Zealand, this part of the world, this AIM system, the Australian Incident Management System, and it's just a system of managed, so we're all on the same page. Now, the police are just starting to buy into it, but the beauty for us is if we run out of people, like we've had 20 IMTs and we run out of people, we can go to New South Wales, can you come and help us in our IMTs? We can actually go to America and say, can you come and help us in our IMTs, because they run NIMS, which is just their National Incident Management System. So it's very similar. So there's this compatibility. Well, we've reviewed AIMS to accommodate some of the police's concerns. When we didn't have intelligence, we didn't have investigations, etc. And so it is about an effort of the fire services to say, hey, this management system is a system that we should use right across the country. And after September 11, the US set up the Department of Homeland Security, and they said everybody, council workers, every emergency service organisation will run this system, because if you know the history of September 11, it was a complete cluster. And we're still trying to come along that journey. So things that have changed in AIMS in the review of it, we've clarified that it is at incident level. I talked about incident, region and state. We've added flexibility, so it can be flexible. Unity of command, which means it's not agency. It's about everybody in the country working together as one. And again, I won't go through them all, other than to say this year we're looking to pilot the intelligence section, which is about getting information, turning that information into intelligence that will inform people like our warnings, our people like our FBAN, the fire behaviour analysis people, our planning people, to try and get more intelligence in. We're going to pilot that this year. That's about all we're doing in regard to AIMS 4. But this change is happening right around the country. And interesting enough, my little footnote is to say it's not really well resourced to implement it. So there's big changes, and we want it all changed, and then we go to training and say, well, you've got to change your manuals, you've got to change your practices, we've got to change. So it's not just saying we're going to do this, we've actually got to change a lot that goes with it. I think we'll move on from that one. Warnings and advice. Interesting, again, in the warnings and advice space, that location-based telephone alerting. So the change this year is, all the telcos are on board. Last year it was only Telstra. This year we've got Optus and Vodafone, so they're all on board. Last year, most of it, I think, I'm not sure when it was implemented, but certainly this year, it's location-based. So we can draw a polygon around an area and say every mobile phone in that area will get a message, where it used to go to the billing address. So even if you lived in that area, but were in Sydney on holidays, you'll get your warning. And if you're on holidays in that area, you wouldn't have got a warning. Where now, we can actually do that polygon and everybody gets that warning in that particular space. One source, one message. Effectively, this is to say that when we put a message out, all the agencies put the same message out with the same template and the same look about it, and so there's no inconsistencies. Now, if I go back to, well, unfortunately, 2009, and probably not there long after, if you looked at the CFA webpage, we'd have different information, we'd have completely different information, we'd look differently, it didn't have the same information. So now we're saying, no, there's one avenue, one source, one message from the agencies. So there's consistency across the state in what we're saying. And within that, I talked about the multilingual before. The templates, I'm going to spend a little bit more time on the templates, and community fire refuges. There are three. There was always Woods Point, which is effectively a mine, and there was no others. This year, we're piloting three refuges, two in the Yarra Ranges and one in Moorabool Shire, I think it is. Down in Geelong Way, anyway. Blackwood is where it is. So we're trialling those as well. And Awesome will actually activate sirens, community alert sirens. It will open up refuges and do that type of work for us. So it is all interconnected. These are the templates. The first thing that you probably see out of that is the colour. So there's... we've actually moved in the modern ages and got some colour we can put into it to make it look a bit fancy. You'll also see it's multi-badged, but the key changes here in these templates, and they are templates, are they give more specific information. So last year, the templates were almost standard, and if you looked at them, and occasionally you do, you almost got to the stage where you knew where the one line of information was, and the rest of it was really generic information. Whether you went for a rubbish bin advice or a warning template, etc., they're all very generic. This year, for the people entering the data in, there's prompts that will say quite specific. We want to get to the stage where we're actually saying, Joan, there's a fire in your spot, and our advice is you go down this road, turn left, and put yourself there. If you're not quite specific, now that's a real challenge for us to get to that layer of detail when we're providing information to the community. That's probably the objective, and again, as I said before, these things continue to improve as we get more specific information. And again, you can see we've still have some generic information about safety, but the other interesting thing here, which is good, are these hyperlinks. So if somebody, now you don't have to go and look up yourself, you can just link on if you want more information out about a specific subject, it will take you there. Pretty simple sort of stuff, but compared to where we were last year, it's probably continued to improve the services in this particular area. The other thing, again, about standards of warnings, we debated where we put this up, but it's interesting to know that the warnings just aren't someone saying, oh, look, I reckon it should be this, or I reckon it should be that. What you see here, so if I take you down to the grass FDI between 50 and 99, if it's impacted a fire of within, say, 2 to 6 hours, then you issue a watch and act message. So it's quite specific to the warnings and advice people. It says, right, if you think the fire is going to impact, if the danger is this and it's going to impact on the community in this amount of time, then this is the warning that you need to go to. There's no subjectivity to it. Well, there's a little bit in there, I guess. And subjectivity is, well, okay, fire behaviour people, how long is that fire away? And when will they be impacted? And is it direct flame contact? Is it smoke? Those sort of issues. But a lot more of the subjectivity, so we can actually be quite specific in when and what we give people in a timing sense. So it's just sort of interesting to know and have that background. And what you don't see up there, interesting enough, is the evacuation. So that's determined by the incident controller, and that's never really been, that trigger's never really been pulled in anger, but it has in training. Any questions on any of that? Aircraft, we're getting towards the end of it now. A couple of things that we didn't talk about up front. One of the chiefs, in fact, driven by our chief, was to really focus on hitting fires hard and fast and changing some of our ways that we do our business. The general thinking is here that if we can get them out early and resource them heavily, we may make some mistakes and over-resource initially, but if they save fires from extending into weeks, and in some instances 2006, 2003, and in months, then it would be well and truly money well spent within the state. Now, weigh that up against bean counters, and people have different views. What we've decided this year is to do a couple of things. Predetermined dispatch expanded. In other words, on a trigger point day in a high risk area, let's go back a step. Historically, if I wanted an aircraft, I literally had to ring the phone or pick the radio up and ask for an aircraft. And this is the aircraft I want. What's happening this season? We started it last year and it's being expanded this season. No. If it's in a trigger point day and it's in a high risk area, that's, I almost, the Battle of Britain, you know, the helicopter people, we scramble themselves and they jump in there and they can deploy themselves. Now, there's some safety issues that we need to make sure there's aircraft officers, air attack supervisors, and that whole support mechanism. So it's not just as simple as it sounds, but those sort of safety procedures are being put in place to ensure that happens. The other one, is a bit of a wanky term in my view, is this wolf pack concept, which is they'll hunt in packs, is all it means. Now, it sounds like we've been watching too many TV movies, but for some reason it's stuck, and whereby in a couple of locations now, you will actually not get one aircraft, you automatically will get two or maybe three aircraft, and they will be much more effective working as a pack to go and hit the fire. An interesting side note, I got an email from, last year we tried a new helicopter up in Sea Lake because of declining volunteerism, a big crop area, etc. And so, and really positive feedback where the aircraft are getting on scene, able to at least slow the fire up, which give time for our trucks to get on scene. So being really, really effective and quite impressive. Almost embarrassing why we haven't done that or thought of that in the past. Cycles for the aircraft. Look, we have on average about 50 aircraft pre-deployed across the state, all strategically located. Sometimes we go at a state level, we'll go, look, tomorrow, you saw Tony, you were actually able to say to us, tomorrow it's going to be the Western District at up until 3 o'clock, but as it moves over, it'll become Gippsland. We're actually able to go, right, we're going to put a crane, we'll put it in at Essendon. Once it's finished there, we might put it back down in Latrobe Valley. We can move subtly some aircraft, but again, you've got to have air attacks, you've got to have fuel tankers, you've got to have nominated air bases and et cetera that goes with that. So a change in the way we do our aircraft, but we're always being challenged about how effective, they cost a fair amount of money, do we get value for money, et cetera. So we need to continually justify that. EMAP functionality. Probably, I reckon, one of the best things that CFA and DEPI, probably one of the first things we've actually got together and developed a product collaboratively together that I think someone might be in the room has won awards. It's practically used. And interesting, it was designed by the user, at the end of the day, by our people and DEPI people. And effectively, what the EMAP does, it allows you to go on and it's overlay. There's overlays on it. So fire at point B, it'll tell you in a spatial sense where the prediction of that fire will be at a certain given time. So we had that last year, and you can see, it put a bit of a plot up there for us. The big change this year is consequence analysis. In that footprint, it'll actually tell us how many schools, if there's a pine plantation, if there's a nursing home, if there's a structural risk in the area, whether that's just a touristy area, what are the things that are actually in the area. So when we're planning, we go, I didn't know there was a scout camp there in the front of this fire, and we can start to focus our energies to the consequence of this particular fire. Again, a pretty simple step, but I reckon for us pretty exciting. The FLIR imagery interrogation, it's integrating the aircraft so we can validate some of that with the aircraft. In fact, I didn't say in the aircraft, we've got an aircraft this year for the first time will just have a gimbal on it that will actually just take photos so we can actually make some decisions from, not from the air, but it'll feed it back into the IMT so we can get live understanding of what's happening with the fire. So some really good stuff happening in this EMAP area, and is available to everybody that pretty well works in an IMT or in the field. You get that sort of product that we can put into the field. If I go back when I first started, we never got maps. The key messages, the last slide, our job is the protection of life. The state's job is the protection of life, and part of that life is that we don't put a value judgment on. It is also, or includes, the life of our people. So if you like the statement you might have heard in some location, everybody comes home. Now, when you make those sort of statements, sometimes our people get pretty pissed off when you take a risk-averse approach. And we've made decisions before, we're not putting our people in. Our people will love to go in, but sometimes they don't go in because they're coming home. And sometimes that's a hard decision to make, but nonetheless, where everybody comes home and our job is to protect community. And don't get me started on community safety, because we'll probably save more environment on empowering communities than we will ever in a fire truck, but I won't go down that track. Safety of our crews and safety of our people is everything we do as a number one priority, and we work as one integrated team. Look, we still haven't nutted that one, but again, if you look at the bigger picture, if I go back not long ago, there was literally fights on the fire ground with different agencies, and we're a wet agency, DSE or a dry agency. We'd put fire out and they'd come along and light them up again. And so there was blues between the... We don't do that anymore. We actually do get on, believe it or not. There is a healthy respect for each other when we sit in an IMT, whether it's a CFA patch or a DEC patch, we don't care. As long as the person has the competencies and the qualifications to the job, that's all we worry about. We work together, we train together, we all get on pretty well. But we need to improve communications, we need to improve systems, etc. So that, again, will be an iterative process as we go, as we improve.